Hello, and welcome back to History for Today. This morning I want to begin sharing the first chapter of my U.S. History 2 survey course. And I'm going to break this chapter into a bunch of small kind of bite-sized chunks. In this first chapter, I want to focus mostly on the conflict between capital and labor. Later I'll look at other things that are happening during this Gilded Age period as well. But let's begin with financial instability. Although the Civil War was about slavery and not about states' rights, as many revisionists have often claimed, it is true that the war, and especially its aftermath, catalyzed a widespread increase in federal power at the expense of state and local and even personal control. The Lincoln administration's Pacific Railroad Act, for example, created a new transcontinental rail industry, and its elimination of state banking in favor of a system of national banks consolidated credit in eastern financial markets, primarily in New York City. And government spending and tax policy during and after the war helped to create new industries, such as Standard Oil, which, among other things, benefited from a prohibitive tax that made grain alcohol uncompetitive with kerosene as a fuel oil. Federal control and concentrated economic power seemed to promise a new era of national economic management for the newly reunited and now continental nation. But neither government nor big business were really able to effectively tame the boom and bust business cycles that continued to plague the American economy. This is a railroad map of the United States showing the through lines of communication from the Atlantic to the Pacific and steamship lines along the seaboard in 1886. Note the time zones, which had been just introduced in 1883 to standardize rail scheduling and American commerce. And that's why we have time zones. So to continue, the speculative bubble created by railroad financing burst in the panic of 1873, which began a period called the Long Depression that lasted until nearly the end of the century, and which before the Great Depression of the 1930s was known simply as the Depression. The panic began with the failure of the largest bank in America, owned by railroad speculator Jay Cooke. The United States government's decision to stop coining silver dollars in 1873 and to return to the gold standard in 1875 exacerbated this financial distress, and lower wages and deflation led to labor disputes like the Great Railroad Strike of 1887. Rail lines slashed wages, although the workers complained, they continued to reap enormous government subsidies and to pay shareholders lucrative stock dividends. Workers struck from Baltimore to St. Louis, shutting down railroad traffic, which was the nation's economic lifeblood across much of the country. Panicked business leaders and their political allies reacted quickly. When local police forces would not or could not suppress the strikes, governors called on state militias or even on federal troops to break them and to restore rail service. Many striking workers destroyed rail property rather than allowing militias to reopen the rails. The protest approached a class war. The governor of Maryland deployed the state's militia. In Baltimore, the militia fired into a crowd of striking workers, killing 11. And wounding many more. Strikers convulsed towns and cities across Pennsylvania. The wealthy president of the Pennsylvania Railroad, Thomas Andrew Scott, who had been Assistant Secretary of War for Abraham Lincoln, is often listed as one of the first robber barons of the Gilded Age. Scott suggested that if striking workers complained that they were hungry, then they should be given what he called a rifle diet for a few days, and see how they like that kind of bread. When police in Pittsburgh refused to put down the protests, the governor responded by calling out the militia, and the militia killed 20 strikers with bayonets and rifle fire. A month of chaos erupted. Strikers set fire to the Pittsburgh rail yards, destroying dozens of buildings, over 100 engines, and over 1,000 rail cars. In Reading, strikers destroyed rail property, and an angry crowd of sympathizers bombarded militiamen with rocks and bottles. The militia responded, once again, by firing into the crowd, killing 10 people. A general strike erupted in St. Louis, one of the hubs connecting the U.S. to the new transcontinental network. Strikers seized rail depots and declared their support for the eight-hour day and for the abolition of child labor. These were their radical demands. Federal troops and vigilantes fought their way into the main St. Louis depot, killing 18 people and finally breaking the strike. Rail lines were shut down across neighboring Illinois, where coal miners struck in sympathy. The Working Man's Party, founded in 1876, organized a protest in Chicago that was attended by tens of thousands. 20 protesters were killed in Chicago by special police and militiamen. The Working Men's Party reorganized in 1878 as the Socialist Labor Party, which still exists today. Courts, police, and state militia suppressed the strikes, but it was federal troops that finally defeated them. When Pennsylvania and West Virginia militiamen were unable to contain the strikes, federal troops were called in. On the orders of President Rutherford B. Hayes, American soldiers were deployed all across Northern rail lines. Soldiers moved from town to town, suppressing protests and reopening the lines. About 6 weeks after it had begun, the strike was finally crushed. Nearly 100 Americans died in what became known as the Great Upheaval. Workers destroyed nearly $40 million worth of property. The strike galvanized the country. It convinced laborers of the need for institutionalized unions, and it persuaded businesses of the need for even greater political influence and government aid. And it foretold a half a century of labor conflict in the United States. So before we continue, some questions to think about. Firstly, why did the power of the federal government expand so much during the Lincoln administration? Secondly, how did the consolidation of credit and financial markets aid the growth of big business? And finally, why did corporate executives like Thomas Andrew Scott and government leaders like the governors of these states feel justified using deadly force against striking workers?